Council, Heather and Delaney, gentlemen. I'm making this video because apparently no one has the time or the wherewithal to respond to my letters in writing or by even dropping an email to invite me to call. I thought I might as well go a bit more personal, give you something visual and audio, and make my challenge a bit more, bit easier to relate to, shall we say, since you can see my face, and I'm sure you all recognize me. So maybe this brings back memories or sentiment, considering I was a member in good standing at your church for 7+ years before my father was terminated, and was a member, if on the rolls only, until recently when you forwarded my paperwork to my church here in the UK. Christian principle and standards of leadership, according to the Bible, would seem to dictate that you not continue to ignore me, since my issues, the issues I raise with you are perfectly legitimate and are questions of transparency, integrity, fairness, justice, and also a matter of church order, which some people like to throw around as a shield for their conduct and an excuse for poor or hasty decision making. They hide behind it and hide behind other people involved who also use the church order as a means of legitimizing their choices and their priorities. So, again, considering I was a member in good standing for a long time and until recently, and I appealed to you while still a member back in 2016 and more recently, a few months ago, I think you owe me. I loved Aetna. I served that church as well as I was able, being somewhat seasonal given my university obligations and the fact that I didn't live in Falmouth all the time. Loved that church, served it, got involved, and of course was married there. Most, if not all of you, were present at my wedding. Several of you or my family members or your family members were involved. Bob, your wife, helped cater the hors d'oeuvre reception, for example. Don, you and your wife came and danced at the reception. Heidi and her mom played piano and organ for the ceremony. It was lovely. They did such a wonderful job. We shared family Thanksgivings with you. I don't know how many years. Heather, you were someone who came and sought me out when I visited in September of 2016. I thought that took courage, considering how many people avoided me. I always appreciated that. Gord, you were the only man who had the integrity to write to me when I reached out to the church in summer of 2016. So I appreciate that. And of course, John, you and Gail drove all the way down to Chicago to rescue me after I got stranded on this side of the Atlantic in September of 2012. Probably never really thanked you properly for that, but it sure saved me a lot of time and headache. These are things I remember with great fondness, in spite of all that's happened, and in spite of the way I've been treated, and my family's been treated, by some of you and by others in the church, and especially by the Council of 2015. Oh, I forgot, Ken. Of course, you and your wife did a lot, especially Beth, to make the wedding happen. Also helped so much with my sister's wedding a year and a half ago. You both have been a tremendous blessing to our family. But I wouldn't know that any of this history exists based on your treatment of me. You're ignoring me, ignoring very fair questions. Nothing is what I get. So, but setting all the personal history aside, I'm a Christian. You're a Christian. Each one of you is a Christian. And you've been elected to leadership of this church. What do you think you owe other believers in terms of transparency and in terms of just common courtesy? Love is not rude, for example. And if you believe that the Council of 2015 did the right thing, why can't you take the time to say so? If you think it was all justified, then justify it. It could be that you won't persuade me, but for your own honor, I would imagine that you'd prefer to provide a defense. But maybe not. Maybe I'm confused about that. On the other hand, if you think it was wrong, as somebody recently said, nobody's perfect, then perhaps you should admit that. It'd be much easier to move on from all this if we can have a little honesty. Because I, for one, am not going to move on. There's been no justice. There's been no attempt at reconciliation or restoration. And after the long list of instances of malfeasance, both by certain members of the 2015 Aetna Council and the classes Northern Michigan, I'd hate to think that you were willfully adding to that list by continuing to prolong this lack of closure, continuing to prolong the grief, and treat people as if they don't exist, or as if their opinions or their experience don't matter, in spite of the fact that we're all supposed to be brothers and sisters in Christ. If you think that Aetna's council in 2015 again did the right thing, I think you owe me that explanation and that interaction. Of course, if you think that what they did was a mistake, that perhaps it would have been better to ask my dad to take another call rather than terminating him on false premises and accompanied by the bullying, the intimidation, the defamation, the slander, the violation of the termination agreement on the day it was signed. If you think all of that could have been done better or should have been done differently, then I think you should acknowledge that and encourage the men who made that decision to apologize. I think all this is only fair. Why am I putting this up on YouTube and making it public? Well, as you may well know if you've been paying attention to evangelical news, the church is getting a bad rap all the time because of these high-profile pastors and high-profile churches doing the wrong thing, sometimes for years. And people in the leadership or people on the ground stand up to the elders or the pastors and say, look, this is wrong. You have been treating women wrongly. You haven't been faithful to your wife. You've been gambling with church money. You have been spending church money on hunting trips. You've been keeping a shadow budget from the rest of the church. And those folk are demonized. The leadership and the pastors cover up. They deny everything until finally they can't deny it anymore. We just saw recently with Bill Hybels in Willow Creek, James McDonald in Harvest Bible Chapel. These people are putting a black eye, giving the church a black eye. I don't think we need any more of that in churches of any number or of any level of fame. I really think it's important that people do the right thing. And that should be important to every Christian. I don't know why it doesn't seem to be important to all of you. I can only imagine what it's like to try to lead a church that's been vacant for 3 years. But that's not my fault. That was the fault of the people who made that choice. And my family has been adversely affected, and I would say has suffered much more than the church has, though the church has suffered as well. You owe us. You owe me. And you don't have the right to fob me off anymore. I don't suppose this will get a reaction, but it's going off onto the internet, and any Christian in particular who's interested in seeing what's going on in these little pockets of rural Reformed Christianity can bear witness to what you've done and continue to do and how you treat people. I guess that's all I have to say, although probably I'll be posting more videos now that I've broken the ice with this one. So you can look for those. And of course, I doubt many of you have taken the time to check out my blog. It's still there. It's still being visited. It has all the documentation. So the accusations I made earlier about bullying, intimidation, wrongful termination, all those things that are actually illegal under employment law, defamation, slander, all of that's proven there. And you all are lucky that you haven't been sued. If this were a corporate situation, you probably would have been already. And so would members of classes. I shouldn't say you all personally, probably those who were on the Aetna 2015 council may very well have been defendants in a lawsuit, if such a thing were to have happened by now. Again, I allege that Aetna's 2015 council, in cooperation with members of classes Northern Michigan, did the wrong thing. And my father and my family have suffered as a result, and so has the reputation of the church in your community, and so has the soul of Aetna and the souls of her people. counter that, respond to it. That is incumbent on you. That is a duty that you have as leaders in this church where this action took place. You know how to get in touch with me. You know the address of my blog, and you know my email, and you also have my father's phone number. So get in touch at your leisure, but preferably sooner rather than later, because reconciliation is important. It's in the Bible, and also it's an active, well, something that was prioritized by Synod just this past year. The CRC has apparently been very bad about healing wounds, taking care of the Christian wounded in the church, been very bad at reconciliation and restoration. So those of us in the CRC have been encouraged by the leadership to take this admonition on board, be better about it, take it seriously, actually follow scripture, and live according to Jesus' injunctions. So perhaps you'd like to show you take that seriously, show us a little love and a little integrity, and respond to my questions. Either provide a justification for what Aetna's council did, or begin the process of reconciliation by acknowledging they did wrong and apologize.